Welcome to Digital Nation, the best of local TV from across the UK. Our stations introduce you to the stories you wouldn't normally see. From the coffee shop owner in a tight squeeze to sunbathing seals on London's South Bank and the Edinburgh pony with a passion for kilts. So, let's take you on a journey across our digital nation. Liverpool seems to be the epicentre of turtle surgery. And if it isn't, it should be. Where else would a vet go the extra mile for a turtle with a wonky eye? You see, this turtle is tiny, and I mean seriously small. Warning, this one is not for the squeamish.
This is a tiny little musk turtle that was brought in by an owner because there's a problem with the eye. Right eye's fine, left eye's abnormal. This is at the extreme end of small animals. This little musk turtle weighs 9 grams. There's matter stuck under the eyelids and it's causing a lot of irritation. And if we don't do something about this, it's going to go blind and there's a lot of discomfort. We need to do something. We just can't leave this alone. When we've got small things, is we use magnification. We can use things called operating loops, which go on the end of my glasses. But this is really tiny. So we're going to use a thing called a dissecting microscope. This is normally for doing very fine, detailed dissection of creatures for research and for knowing how they work. And we're going to use it to look at the eye. Right, we've set up the dissecting microscope and we've put some extra light sources so we've now got a good view of this little turtle's head and eye. But he's moving around too much and we can't hold the eye still. So we're now going to give the anaesthetic. With these little animals, it's difficult to know, is it still alive? Because particularly terrapins and tortoises, they don't do a lot, particularly under anaesthetic. So what we've used here is called a fetal pencil Doppler ultrasound. So what you're hearing there is the heartbeat of this tiny 8 gram turtle. This animal, I think, has a vitamin A deficiency because the diet hasn't quite been good. And this is all due to vitamin A deficiency. Once you've flushed this out and changed the diet, we should do okay with this little one. We're recovering from the anaesthetic. We're moving around brightly, happily. No ill effects from the anaesthetic. I'm just going to pop him back.
Over to Glasgow now. Remember the Commonwealth Games last year? Well, one young gold medalist dropped by the STV studios. And he stopped off at his old job too. After all, his post had been piling up.
I was 11 year old when I started fighting. I had my first fight just down the road. I think we won about the first 16, 18 on the trot. Won every title, beat every boy from England, Wales, beat everybody. And that's when we kind of got highlighted as a talent. In this gym, we moved right up to winning the British title at senior level when I was 18 years old. So. Started small, but we got there eventually.
So I left school at 16. I was in here for I was 17. So 17 till I was 20, about 3 years, just over 3 years I was in here. I was training like 2 hours before I came in the morning, then doing my shift, and then training for 2-3 hours at night. It was hard with dieting and all that. You're coming in and everybody's eating chippies and saucy suppers and all that, and you can only eat wee bits and bobs. This man here is the main man. This man here is my PR man. He was my advisor through all the rough times.
I like your personal guru type thing.
I would agree with that 100%.
Motivational speaking and things like that, wouldn't it?
That's it.
Just to see him kind of achieve all his dreams, everything that he wanted, it was brilliant to see. And it was brilliant for everybody that supported him all the way through it.
This is Colin McLeod, plant manager. He was the one that was always giving me my time off.
I mean, you went to Serbia as well. You went to Serbia, so we gave him some time off for that. He did some great training. The feedback from his trainers that he'd done really well. And then he came in and told me he was going to win the gold medal at the Commonwealth Games. he wasn't the favourite. There was some really good boxers in his weight division. So we changed his duties. We gave him the Saturday off. And we really followed his training plan. So we looked at what his coach had said and we worked around it as best we could. And I think it worked out brilliant. And of course, the rest is history. So we haven't forgotten him and he hasn't forgotten us.
At a young age, it's important just to have fun. Get in the ring, get your sparring done. And just compete, have fun. And as things progress, it will get more serious. But just go to the gym, and if it's for you, stick in at it, because it will pay off.
X Factor winner Joe McAldrey is doing all right. He popped home to South Shields to see his folks. But he couldn't resist fitting in a quick gig and a chat with Made in Tyne & Wear.
Just as the sun is about to come out, I am joined by Joe McAldrey, everybody's favourite in the northeast.
Oh, thank you.
How are you?
I'm good, and I'm worshipping the sun. I'm being very nice to it because I want it to stay all day.
Yeah, everybody knows how fond you are of South Shields
and
the northeast. So you must be so excited about today.
Well, this is the third time I think I've done it, but it's obviously lovely to be back with Calabro and Lola, who are both from the northeast. And I think it's just really nice. You know, obviously we're ending the summer festival today, and I think it's just great. It just shows how supportive people are in Shields and the northeast.
Oh, people have got banners and t-shirts.
I love
and
it.
All kinds out
I love
there.
It.
So obviously you are in London now at the moment.
Well, yeah, I mean, I still pretty much live up here, but I'm always back and forwards and stuff. But I've had a couple of weeks off, so I've been home for about a week and a bit.
Oh, and
so
you're
enjoying
nice. Yourself.
Yeah, it's been nice.
Well, now I've got something in common with you, because I used to work at the customs house.
Yes.
As did you.
Did you? You didn't wash the dishes, did you?
No. I made you wash my dishes.
I washed the dishes.
No, but I used to work on the box office, and I've seen you perform at the customs house before, and everybody, there was not one person on the seat. Everybody was up dancing.
Well, that's the idea. We've got a big section at the end, which is like a massive sing-along thing, and I want to kind of get everybody going crazy. There's a big, like, the last song, the last, like, 2.5 minutes is like a full-on audience interaction kind of party. So hopefully they'll get up. And if it's not, and if it's raining, we'll have to get them up anyways to warm them up.
It sounds a lot better than washing the dishes and selling the tickets.
True. But I did love it there. God, I love the customs house as well.
Fantastic. Enjoy yourself. They're out there and they're ready for
Can't
you.
Wait.
They're a proud bunch in Brighton. And once a year, they're so proud they burst in an explosion of rainbow flags and carnival floats. Here's Pride 2015, Brighton style.
A sea of colour sets off from Hove Lawns as a wave of floats kickstart Brighton Pride. From Sussex Police to the Gay Men's Choir, even the horses got involved with the celebration of the LGBT community.
I just love how everyone's out on the street. It's just such a good party atmosphere, and you don't even have to be like going to any of the venues. You can literally just step outside your door and you're in the parade and you're having fun with lots of people.
Like every year, thousands of people turned out to get a piece of the action. The flamboyancy of not only the floats, but also the performers, reflecting the diverse nature of the event. Meanwhile, in Brighton Kemp Town, a street party like no other got underway. Last year, ticketing was introduced to try and control the number of people attending, not that these people minded.
I just think it's a great experience for everyone, of every sex, gender, coming together, celebration. It's good fun.
Over in Preston Park, at the heart of the celebrations was a lineup of some of the biggest stars in music, including Ella Henderson, Foxes, Talisa, and Brighton's very own Fatboy Slim.
Remember the old telephone boxes? Well, in Birmingham, the old red kiosk has been given a whole new lease of life and an aroma of freshly ground coffee beans too. Yep, the old call box is now a coffee box. I bet you can't reverse the charges though.
A coffee shop in a telephone box. What's this all about?
I don't know. People have been asking me this all day. It all started when I kind of left school. I knew I always wanted to be self-employed. And it kind of just went from there. I was walking through a town one day. I live in the jewellery quarter. I was walking through a town, saw that they were up to rent, contacted the company, said, oh, what's it all about? What can I do with them? They suggested the coffee idea. And I thought, that's a really good idea, because I do like coffee. That is a really good idea.
And so it's your first day of opening today. How's it going?
It's been interesting. It's been, no one will come, and then all of a sudden a million people will turn up at once. It's been so crazy. But yeah, I've really enjoyed it. People have really responded well to it.
So what has the response been like? What are people saying?
People just think it's mental. People just see it, though, it's a British icon, and they would have went to waste otherwise. So this is a good way to sort of recycle it and don't let it go to waste.
And is there any other concept like this? Have you heard of any other concept like this?
There is one in Brighton. I did go down there 2 weeks ago, but he's got two, whereas this is one. So this is officially Britain's smallest coffee shop, officially.
Officially.
Yeah.
And how does that make you feel?
Proud. Yeah, why not?
And so what are, you know, your future plans? Are you going to keep this open for a long time?
It's got 3-year lease, and there is 4 more along this road. I would like all of them. I would definitely like all of them eventually, but we'll see. We'll see.
You're going to see how today goes, and then hopefully...
Yeah, I don't want to jump in the deep end just yet. We'll just see how today goes. Every time I go to Brighton, every time I go to London, it's full of independence. It's like full of really crazy stuff. And I thought, Birmingham doesn't lack necessarily independence, but there's not as many, and there's definitely room for a lot more. So this is why, that is another one of the reasons why I wanted to do this.
Quiz time now. J.K. Rowling penned her first novel in the Harry Potter series in which city? Was it A, Oxford, B, Edinburgh, or C, Belfast? Join us after the break for the answer. Welcome back to Digital Nation. Before the break, we asked you, in which UK city did J.K. Rowling pen the first novel in her Harry Potter series? And the answer is B, Edinburgh, on the George IV Bridge. No one can deny Belfast is on the up. Even the city's gardeners are thinking tall. But a garden that's higher than a house? That's genius. Somebody's going to need a very long hose.
The shipyard was the heartbeat of this community for years. I mean, tens of thousands of people were employed there 50, 60 years ago. Statistically, it's the fifth worst ward out of 566 electoral wards in Northern Ireland.
We know from the theory of urban regeneration that you need to give communities pieces of physical infrastructure by which they will come to identify their community. I think we've really managed to put something really beautiful and also something really functional on this part of the road, which is a three-storey high garden on the side of a wall, which is the only one on the island at the moment. But we wanted to do something beautiful, really, and also in recognizing that Belfast is a city of walls that divide, and we thought we could do something different with a wall, make a wall living, make it change over the seasons, make it something really imaginative and attractive.
What do you do with a local TV reporter who's scared of heights? Easy. You persuade her to travel in a hot air balloon. Oh, Made in Bristol, you're so mean. And we love it.
We're running through the fields, trying to find our balloon and keep up with Kelly, who's organising it all here. Would you like to... It's just amazing. My heart's actually started to race because I am actually scared of heights, and I've never been in a balloon before. Seeing it all inflated behind me, it's feeling like it's going to happen, and it's a reality. But Tom's with me, and he's done it before, so I've got some strength in numbers. We're off. What a fantastic morning. It's so beautiful up here. Just behind Richard, I can see the Severn Estuary, the Severn Bridge. There's lots of balloons in the sky as well. This is absolutely magnificent. Come meet me in the sky.
A new task force has been set up in Nottingham by local school children in order to educate its older citizens on how to use the latest in tablet technology.
This is Hall Park Care Home in Bulwell, and today the residents have ditched books and bingo for a lesson in 21st century technology. It's all thanks to pupils from Ellis Guildford Secondary School in Old Basford, who put down their textbooks to teach the elderly about iPads.
I've just shown him an app on this.
He's a wizard with that.
iPad.
iPad.
And it wasn't just residents being taught some new tricks on a touchscreen, as the kids also got a lesson in knitting.
Well, it's something that we can share. I mean, so often old people and young people, it's a big divide. Shouldn't be. Because we could be, you know, we've been young once, but sometimes we forget what it was like to be young once. Sort of frown on what they're doing, but we shouldn't, because we did it.
From listening to their favourite songs to finding out the weekly weather forecast, the class certainly picked up a few extra skills.
Loch Ness has its monster, but what lurks beneath London's Thames? Well, more wildlife than you might think. Even the team at London Live were surprised to see these little fellas.
We have been completing the Thames Marine Mammal Sighting Survey for the last 10 years, and over 1,000 Londoners have submitted sightings to the survey, which is absolutely fantastic. So using that information, we found areas which are hotspots of sightings. So these are areas where more people are spotting marine mammals than any other parts in London. One of which is Canary Wharf, which is really exciting and really interesting. And this may be due to the high-rise glass buildings with a lot of people being able to see the open water around. Or it might actually be due to seals being attracted to this location because of Billingsgate Fish Market, and maybe they're waiting there to get scraps from the fish. We really rely on these public sightings to better understand marine mammal distribution in the Thames Estuary. For example, we see seals all the way up to Teddington Lock, and even we've seen had a number of sightings of whales up to Gravesend. So it's really exciting seeing how these animals are using the estuary, and we use this information to better their conservation.
How much do you really know about where you live? Each week we take a look at a different part of this creative kingdom we call home, to give you some facts and local history you may not be aware of.
So who do we have to thank for flat screen tellies? Is it Japan? No. Is it America? No. Is it Hull? Yes! In 1968, the MOD was spending a packet on old school tellies, and they wanted to do something with liquid crystal. They're a sort of firm but sort of wobbly and can be made to move about like electric jelly. But they needed a type of crystal that would work at room temperature. Enter George Gray of the University of Hull, who went into the lab and created 4-cyano-4-pentyl-biphenyl, the DNA of massive tellies. Because when it comes to creativity, innovation, and having a crystal ball, int Hull Mint.
To Cambridge now, and a sobering look at one of the UK's most shameful periods in history during the slavery years. But as Cambridge TV found out, there's plenty to be proud about too.
St John's College already has a large collection of anti-slavery material, but now it's brought in documents from those who profited from the trade.
So these are a collection of letters and papers from the Jamaican sugar plantation of William Philip Perrin, who was a British landowner in the later half of the 18th century, contemporary with the abolition of the slave trade. They're mostly concerned with the day-to-day running of his estate, but in amongst the daily details are some quite chilling reminders that the estate was also operated by buying and selling slaves. So they were delivered on the 3rd of last month and have ever since been at work settling the peak at Grange Hill and are happy and contented with their situation there. Whether that was true or not, we don't really know, but certainly as a way of reassuring vested business interests back in the UK that everything was going well and there was nothing to worry about. You see this kind of theme cropping up again and again, that the slaves were happy with their lot. So the abolitionist movement was really started by William Wilberforce and Thomas Clarkson, who were both undergraduates here at St John's College. William Wilberforce was an MP, so he was able to give these great stirring speeches in Parliament, making the case from a moral perspective. Clarkson, on the other hand, was gathering evidence, so he would travel to ports like Bristol and Liverpool and actually speak with people involved in the slave trade firsthand. And his evidence was able to bolster the arguments in Parliament. It took them, I think, about 20 years of fairly solid, hard work to actually achieve the Abolition Act in 1807. There is a narrative that is very easy to fall into where we are very self-congratulatory about abolition. And there's nothing wrong with that. It's absolutely right that the abolitionists and their heroism and their success should be front and centre. But papers like the Perrin Collection show that Britain was actually complicit in the slave trade as well. And that's a very dark chapter of our history, but it's something we really shouldn't forget.
And finally, a tattoo in Edinburgh. I'm talking about one of the world's most famous military events at Scotland's most iconic castle in August. And an intrepid pony. And not forgetting the bagpipes.
Tonight, I've come along to the most iconic location in the whole of Edinburgh, the amazing Edinburgh Castle, as it's playing host to the Edinburgh Military Tattoo, which takes place in just a few hours. As you can see, the seats behind me are empty, but they definitely won't be for long.
So I'm Alistair Hutton, the Chief Usher of the Royal Edinburgh Military Tattoo. This is my 40th season at the Edinburgh Military Tattoo. It's stressful, but it's an enjoyable stress. Fantastic venue, it really is. Nothing can beat this one in the world anywhere.
Ever since I was a child, I've been sort of, well, made to watch it by my family, so it's always been something that was just one day I thought, well, I'm going to be part of that. So there I am. It's a strange feeling, really. It's something you never get used to. Like, every time you go through the gates, it's hard to describe, really. It's fantastic.
So, as you can see, we're effectively backstage here at Edinburgh Castle for waiting for the opening of the tattoo tonight. And all these pipers are lined up, ready, and I'm going to follow them for the massed pipes and drums.
Walking out into the tattoo, down the Esplanade and the drawbridge. Wow. Was it a bit that really stood out for you?
Yeah, the Swiss drummers.
Yeah, everything was so precise, but really, all of it was lovely.
That's all we've got time for this week. You can check out more digital films from all the channels featured on the show by visiting their on-demand services online. That will hopefully keep you going until next week, when we will be bringing you more local TV from across the UK in Digital Nation.